Lana Del Rey. That's right, Lana Del Rey. Rock and roll. Deal with it. Edwin Canastracci here, drinking a little scotch in the afternoon. Scotch goes well with Lana, LDR, Lana Del Rey, Lana Del Banana, as I sometimes call her, or Lana Del Taco. Here we go, Glenn Levitt, that's what I'm drinking. It's a new one I just picked up the other day, Founders Reserve. It's all right, it's got kind of a honey taste to it, which I like, which goes really well with Lana Del Rey, honey tasting scotch. Nectar of the gods. Not as good as my Johnny Walker Black, but you know, sometimes you gotta diversify. You gotta mix up your scotch from time to time. So yeah, Lana Del Rey. I know this is probably shocking a lot of people that watch my videos, because you know, usually I do hard rock or heavy metal. I have from time to time thrown a few curveballs, some R&B, some country, but I've never done an artist. Well, this is the thing with Lana Del Rey. Some people consider her a pop artist. Sometimes some people call her indie rock, although she's really not indie rock. There's one album, which we'll discuss, that has kind of an indie rock thing going on with it. Sometimes I've heard people call her an alternative artist. I feel like she's only considered an alternative artist because she's actually good. I mean, really, she's making good pop music. I consider Lana Del Rey a pop artist. She's just very consistent, and her albums are filled with great songs, so people feel like that's alternative. But she's just a great modern day pop artist, and I do like some pop music. And what's interesting about Lana Del Rey is, not only is this my first time reviewing a modern artist, and I do like a lot of modern artists, I just haven't really gotten into it, but I like a lot of different kinds of music. So you know, we only been scraping the surface. Only scraping the surface, people. And this is also my first time doing a female artist. I've not done a female artist before. I love a lot of female artists, but for whatever reason, haven't gotten to one yet. But I figured it was about time. And I love Lana. She's one of my favorite artists. And it's like, if Ralph Vieira can love his ABBA, you know, and Eric RMCP loves his ABBA too, well, Lana Del Rey's like, she's like my ABBA. She's pop music with an edge. And it's really, she's an artist unto herself. Lana just sounds like Lana. She obviously has certain influences, and like a lot of the newer music I do like is somewhat reminiscent of older music, but Lana does a good job of mixing the two aesthetics. You know, on one hand, her stuff, a lot of people talk about like Peggy Lee or Nancy Sinatra, more kind of loungy, sexy kind of female singers from the late 60s, you know, early 70s. On some of her more recent releases, a lot of people bring up Joni Mitchell. Joni Mitchell gets brought up a lot. She's been bringing in a little more of that early 70s singer-songwriter quality to her albums. But especially on her earlier albums, there was also a hip-hop element that was also mixed in with a lot of her stuff. I recall after her second album, a lot of people were saying that she's like the hip-hop Nancy Sinatra. She created a really unique sound, her with a lot of talented producers, but even when she shifts the producer, her music is still very distinctly her music, and she does write all her lyrics. She had a big hand in creating this aesthetic and this persona that she created very early on, even back when she was first breaking out on YouTube and her first self-produced album, Lana Del Rey, which I believe her father paid for. To some people, this might just be pretentious hipster music. I don't think there's anything pretentious about Lana Del Rey, especially her more recent albums. I think her more recent albums have become very, she's very earnest. I think she's a very earnest artist, actually. You can be a cool person, and that's who you really are. And I feel like Lana Del Rey is generally a cool person who's really into music, and she loves culture, and she loves a lot of cool old stuff in the 60s and 70s, which I do as well. And she makes something new out of it. You know, it's a lot, in some ways, what she's doing, it's a little like Quentin Tarantino does with movies. You know, Tarantino, obviously, he's nostalgic for the 60s and 70s, But he also does mix it up, you know? There's kind of a post-hip-hop vibe to Tarantino's movies. So they're not like 100% just nostalgia. It's nostalgia, but with a modern kind of Gen X, kind of postmodern, you know, reinterpretation of all this stuff that he loved. And likewise, I think Lana Del Rey, musically, she's like a millennial equivalent of this, you know? She obviously loves a lot of music from the 60s and 70s, you know, whether it's Joni Mitchell or Nancy Sinatra and all that stuff. But she obviously also likes modern R&B and pop and hip hop. And it's like, it's all in the stew. It's all in the stew. And as she's getting older, she's leaning more and more towards, I would say, the singer-songwriter and the folk influence. But it's still there. There's still, even on her latest album, which is definitely leans heavily on the singer-songwriter folk side, even there's a little bit of hip-hop thrown in and a few modern, I would say modern indie rock elements mixed in as well. So it's music that both respects the past, but it's not like kept in a glass protective case. She does have kid gloves with the past, you know, and she'll curse in songs and just bring a modern edge while at the same time respecting all this cool shit in the past. I think right now she's the greatest pop artist making music right now. If we're talking like newer pop artists, people whose first album, you know, was less than 20 years ago, then to me, Lana has no competition. She's amazing. I'm a huge fan. I love all her albums. She's very consistent. That's the thing too about Lana. And you know, there's a lot of, especially in pop and R&B these days, they're very single driven and you know, there'll be two or three good songs, but then there's a lot of filler on the album, a lot of guest spots, you know, and it's not like an artist can't really hold, they don't really care about the art of the album anymore, you know? A lot of underground acts do, but in terms of pop music, there's not a lot of acts where you can listen to an album from beginning to end and it's all good and all, it's a statement. The album's a statement. Not the story of Lana Del Banana. Her albums are definitely a statement. She's definitely an album artist. You know, I recall a couple years back, I was reading some magazine article and it was a list of the top 10 selling vinyls that year. And 9 out of the 10 albums were old classic rock albums like Pink Floyd and Led Zeppelin, stuff like that, the Beatles, you know. And Lana Del Rey was the only person that cracked in the top 10 with a new album in the vinyl, you know, community, which, you know, and that tells you kind of who her fan base is too. These are people that do want to listen to albums. They don't want to just listen to a song here or there. And Lana, I mean, she has a lot of catchy songs, a lot of these songs. I'm surprised she doesn't have more hits. Every album that she's released to me has a handful of songs that should be top 10 hits, but it's only just because the music scene is really lame these days. I feel like if this was any other time period, Lana would be even bigger, you know? She wipes the floor with the competition. She never disappoints. You know, there are some albums that take me a month or two to really fully get into, especially in recent years. But once I get into them, I get into them big time. And that's one of the things that prompted this video, because recently I've gotten really into some recent albums of hers. But hell, we're gonna rank them. People like a ranking. It makes, adds some drama to the video. Keeps it more interesting than just doing it chronological. And as with all these rankoramas, it is subject to change. This is just me right now, first month of the new year, 2022. This is how I'm feeling. This is how I'm going into 2022, Lana Del Rey-wise. This is my ranking of her 8 albums, 7 of which I own. Yes, the one on the bottom, which we're going to start with right now, I don't own. It's her first album. I think a lot of people don't own this because it's out of print. Number 8, Lana Del Rey, her debut album. Independent release, not a bad debut. In fact, if it was available to purchase, I would own this. I think it's all right. Definitely her weakest album. She sounds young on it. Her voice is not all the way there yet. And the production's a little weak and it sounds a little amateurish. I can understand why she pulled this album. She pulled this album off of iTunes and I can kind of get why. Like it should, maybe she could re-release it with a remix or remaster and it'll beef it up a little bit. But yeah, it sounds a little slight. That being said, there are some good songs on it, especially the first track, Kill Kill. That's a great song. Kind of loungy, kind of Hawaiian pop, hip-hop, Peggy Lee sounding kind of song. I like it. I like it a lot, actually. It's a cool song. And there's some cool stuff. Yayo, which would end up on the Paradise EP, which I'll just say right now, Paradise EP, if I was counting that, I would give that the edge on this. But that would probably be like, that would be 8 and this would be 9 if we were counting the Paradise EP, which is almost an album. Just misses it by like a few minutes. It's like there are 8 songs on that. The song Ride is amazing. Love Ride. But Paradise does sound like something that she rushed out really quick because of the success of Born to Die. So that's what I think of Paradise, if you were wondering. And of course, that's sometimes included as a bonus disc with Born to Die. But back to her first album, it's a good start. One thing that's really impressive is even as a young girl here, Lana Del Rey, aka Lizzie Grant, she pretty much has the persona down. Like already, she has the persona and the aesthetic down. This mixing of modern pop and hip hop with old school, loungy, sexy music, you know, she kind of got it down already. And that's very impressive. You know, that's, you could tell like this, no wonder why her next album would be on a major label. This is a pretty impressive demo. I don't think most young artists come out of the gate this defined. So she was pretty defined right out of the gate. But obviously the next album would be a huge, huge leap, but we're not there yet because we're doing this as a Rank-A-Rama. That's right. Lana Del Banana Rank-A-Rama. Here we go. So number seven is 2017's Lust for Life. Lust for Life. I do like it, and it's grown on me. When I first heard this album and the singles from it, I was disappointed. I thought Lana was selling out. Yep, I said it. I said she's selling out. She's bringing in guest R&B singers and hip-hop artists like every other artist does, like Taylor Swift does, you know, all these white girls bring in a rapper and suddenly they think it makes them legit, you know, and cross over to this other audience. I ain't always buying that. And also, this is the thing too, a lot of these artists do, because, you know, their shit's kind of weak. They need help. They need help from this cool hip-hop artist that's going to come in and make their shit a little less weak, a little less vanilla. But Lana doesn't need that shit. And Lana herself is actually a pretty good rapper, as we heard in Born to Die. I want to hear Lana Del Rey sing. Like, in some of these songs, I've realized, like the title track, for example, Lust for Life, it's a really great pop song. Nothing against The Weeknd, but if I want to listen to a Weeknd song, I'll listen to a Weeknd song. I want to listen to Lana Del Rey sing that chorus. That's the thing. I want to hear her singing it. There's just too many guest appearances, and even some of the songs like Love, it's a little saccharine. You know, you could tell that she was definitely trying to make a poppier album here. But still, she's still maintaining the overall aesthetic of a Lana Del Rey album and maintaining her personality. She's not, like, totally losing her personality. And there are some really good songs on it. Cherry's a good song. I really like Cherry a lot. Heroin, very good. Nothing to do with the Velvet Underground Heroin. Really great song. I like the last song, Get Free. There are some really good tracks on this. But overall, too many guest spots. A little too poppy. She softened the edges on this album. I'm curious what other people think. Do other people think this? Did Lana Del Rey have any kind of backlash because of this album? I did notice that she definitely goes in a different direction with the next album. She kind of lays down the gauntlet to kind of make sure you know that she's still legit with the next album. So I wondered if with the fans, they were kind of unhappy with this. Tell me in the comments section. I would like to know. I'm curious if other people felt the way I did, because she definitely didn't do an album like this again after this album. I don't think this did what she was hoping, or her like management or whatever was hoping it would do, because it didn't do as well as Born to Die. Born to Die still to this day is her biggest selling album. So maybe after conceding a bit to the marketplace with this album, she's like, fuck it. I'm just going to be full on, full fledged Lana Del Rey with the next album. Yeah, but we're not getting to that album yet because it's really great. So you got to wait a bit. So what's next? We are talking about her major label debut, which I thought was her first album because I didn't even know about the other album until a couple years later. But like a lot of people, this is the album that put Lana under my radar. Born to Die from 2012. And like I said, this is her biggest selling album. It should have sold more because this is a pop masterpiece. There you go. Only her first album and the last album, Lust for Life, are the only albums that I don't full out love. That's why I decided to do a Lana Del Rey ranking video. Born to Die is an amazing album. First hit of the strings and the title track, that vibe, it's dark romanticism. I love myself some dark romanticism. It goes really well with Scotch. It's sexy. It's passionate. There's soul to it. It's a great song. One of the all-time great pop songs, in my opinion. Born to Die. But then Off to the Races. Remember when I said, hey, Lana Del Banana, she doesn't need any rappers. She doesn't need guest rappers because she can lay down some fucking fly rhymes herself, as she does with this song. Some great white girl rapping. I love it. Great song. It's badass. For a white girl, she's got a lot of swagger, and I love it. And she doesn't give a fuck what you think. And the thing is, she does it too without seeming like a poser. She's not like rapping, like trying to sound like she's a black chick, you know? That's the thing. She sounds like a white chick rapping. And not in that lame Madonna American Life kind of way. She kind of hits the sweet spot, and this is a hard thing to do. It's hard for a white girl to sound cool when she's rapping. She does it. She pulls it off. She knows how to just kind of hit it right and then leads it into the crooning and the singing, and the lyrics are funny. What a great lyricist. Lana's turn of a phrase, no one competes with her these days. Best lyricist out there. That's right. I said it. Lana's number one. Blue Jeans, great song. Video Games, that was a song that was a YouTube sensation. Nice ballad. I like it. It's about how her boyfriend plays video games all the time. National Anthem, one of my favorite songs on the album. Really catchy. Has kind of an 80s vibe. It sounds like a song that should be playing during the end credits of a movie. A lot of Lana Del Rey songs sound like they should be being played during the end credits of a movie or montage. There's something very cinematic. Something very cinematic about her music. All this stuff is great stuff, and it's a great album. It's to her credit that she's got 5 albums better than this album, in my opinion. Obviously, this is all my opinion. Number 5. Now, this album was a bit of a grower, showing a kind of a more sophisticated, mature side, flip side to Born to Die, and that is 2015's Honeymoon. Honeymoon is my 5th favorite Lana Del Rey album. It's a great album. Like I said, it's a little more subtle than some of her other albums, but man, once you get into it, you get into it. The title track, it's great. Music to Watch Boys By, it's great. High on the Beach, that was a single. That's a kind of slow, cool, groovy kind of hip-hop song. Art Deco's great. Salvatore, Swan Song, all this stuff. It's a great album. My same thing about this album is I almost don't think of this album so much in terms of the songs. I just think of it as Honeymoon. It all kind of blends into each other. There's almost a symphonic quality to this album. An amazing production. Very cinematic. It's a mood music. It sounds like the kind of music that's in your head when you're strolling down Malibu and maybe some bad stuff happened the night before, you know? It's got this kind of almost like Giorgio Moroder kind of vibe to it. But yet there's an operatic quality as well. There's an operatic quality. Pure atmosphere. Pure dark side of the California dream kind of atmosphere. It's tragic, romantic, stroll through the beach, high and sad. It's great. I love it. Number 4, an album that's really grown on me. When I first heard this during the Panorama, I was somewhat disappointed by it. I thought, oh, this just sounds like B-sides from Norman fucking Rockwell. But you know what? B-sides from Norman fucking Rockwell is nothing to sneeze at. And I'm talking about Chemtrails Over the Country Club. And yeah, this is her Pandemic album. Talk about mood. Woo! A lot of mood on this album. And this, it creeps in there. It creeps in there. In a lot of ways, this is like her most wistful and darkest album. But it's dark in a gentle, beautiful, highly feminine kind of way. The first song, White Dress, amazing song, great melody. A touch, almost I'd say a little Kate Bush-ish, a little Kate Bush-esque. I feel, and that's an element that's kind of coming in on this album that's a little different from her prior albums. It's the first time it sounded like she was listening to a lot of Kate Bush. Hell, I was listening to a lot of Kate Bush during the Panorama as well. There was something about Kate Bush that made you feel good when you were locked in a house. I don't know why. She was sprinkling like fairy dust around and making you feel good. So I feel like me and Lana were both listening to Kate Bush at this time. But anyway, so White Dress, great song. Love it. Title track's great. Kind of deceptively dark, you know, sounds gentle and beautiful, but there's darkness creeping underneath the surface, which she plays into in the video too, which ends with werewolves, which is pretty cool. Wild at Heart, an amazing song, top tier Lana Del Rey song, Wild at Heart, should have been a single, really catchy song, I love it. It sounds like an instant classic. Probably my favorite song on it would be Dance Till We Die. She's acknowledging Joni Mitchell and a lot of her influences of the past and living and enjoying the past, but in the present. This is her Laurel Canyon song. That's why I think Dance Till We Die is the Laurel Canyon song. Let's get drunk. Let's have some wine. Apache, and then let's get drunk and dance in front of the Jim and Pam house, the Jim and Pam Morrison house outside Apache. That's the vibe I get from this song. I love it. Great cover of a beautiful song by Joni Mitchell, For Free. Great song, one of Joni Mitchell's greatest songs. And in fact, this is my favorite version of it. Yeah, there you go. I like Lana's version better than Joni because I like Lana's voice a little bit better. So there you go. Great job. Great album. It's the kind of album that you gotta give it time, but once you get in there and sink into it, you realize it's one of her best albums. A subtle, beautiful, haunting, modern-day masterpiece. And we still have 3 albums to go. God damn it, is Lana Del Rey a great artist or what? And here we go with her latest album. Yeah, and this also was a grower. When I first heard this, I was like, I liked it, but I wouldn't say I loved it. But within a month, I was loving it. And now I love it so much. That's number 3, 2021's Blue Bannisters. An amazing album. Love that album cover. Well, I love almost every Lana Del Rey album cover. This one with the 2 big dogs, it's great. Objectively, I can say right now, I think objectively, this is her 2nd best album. But subjectively, it's my 3rd. My number 1's a real subjective choice, which I'll explain why when we get there. So subjectively, my 3rd favorite. Objectively, her 2nd best album, in my opinion. Wait, I need to drink a little more scotch before talking about Blue Bannisters. Nectar of the Gods. There we go. It's happening in real time. But it's already the past, as Lana Del Rey would sing a sad song about that. Here we go. Cheers. Blue Bannisters. She builds on what she started with Chemtrails. Takes it to a whole other level. The mood of Chemtrails, but with the melodic heights of Norman fucking Rockwell. It's a perfect album. From the first track, textbook, amazing, epic track, emotional pop track, takes you on a trip. I love the title track. Took me a little while to get into it, but once I did, it's one of my favorite songs now. Very minimalistic. This is probably her most minimalistic song yet. It's just kind of a subtle synthesizer line. Very subtle. Sounds kind of like a piano, but it's a synthesizer. Beautiful lyrics. Love the vibe. Love the mood. The subtle backing harmonies and singing. It's a beautiful song. It's a masterpiece. Arcadia. Beautiful song. Sounds like an instant standard. You know, it's just one of those songs, like I said about Wild at Heart, an instant classic. Well, this sounds like an instant standard. This sounds like this has always been a song. I can't imagine that there was a time when Arcadia wasn't a song. But apparently it wasn't. But Lana plucked it out of heaven somehow and made it a song. Beautiful piano ballad about the LA landscape, which she uses as a beautiful metaphor for her body and love and sensuality. Has a little coda, a hip-hop coda with a little Mirconi vibe to it. Just showing that, you know, she still got a little of that going on. Black Bathing Suit, my 2nd favorite song on the album. Amazing song. Amazing song. Builds on a lot of stuff she's done before. And one of the things that's amazing about Blue Bannisters is Lana really stretches vocally on this album. For the first time, we hear like a new, like unhinged Lana Del Rey that we haven't heard before. And Black Bathing Suit is when you hear this unhinged Lana for the first time. You also hear it on the song Dealer, which is another great song. Yeah, Lana's like kind of screaming and very emotional. Little borderline punk rock. I love the sound of the backing vocals while she's doing that and emoting at the end. It's passionate, it's sensual, it's desperate, it's angry, all at the same time. You know I love things when it's all at the same time. Black Bathing Suits, and a great song, one of her best. If You Lie Down With Me, another wonderful song, great lyrics, has a kind of old school kind of soul vibe. Love when the horns come on at the end. Great lyrics, wonderful song. My favorite track on the album, Thunder. Love this song, man. In fact, I would say this is probably my favorite Lana Del Rey song. Right now. Right now, this is my favorite. And it's not a song I've heard a lot of people talk about. It doesn't hit you right away as a standout. But Once you really get into this song, you just realize how this is just pure soul music. She really captures, it's almost, it reminds me of stuff like from the Dusty in Memphis album, Dusty Springfield. It has that kind of vibe to it, but yet again, in that post-hip-hop kind of way that Lana does. I love the lyrics, I love the attitude, I love the pathos, the melody. It's a perfect song. It's just this little, perfect, beautiful, sexy, catchy song, and gets under your skin. Gets under your skin, Thunder. Love it. Wildflower, Wildfire, another great song. Nectar of the Gods, there you go. Living Legend, another one of my favorite songs on the album. Amazing. Just sounds like a Lana Del Rey song. She's at a point as an artist where she just has her own sound sometimes. And this is a song I can only describe as epic, tragic, beautiful Lana Del Rey pop song. There you go. Cherry Blossom and Sweet Caroline, the two last songs. It ends the album on a gentle, very feminine kind of vibe. When I first heard this album, I said to a friend that I feel like Lana Del Rey's just making music for women now. I said that. I'll admit it. I said it. I felt like her earlier albums, she was making them for both men and women. And I said, with her last two albums, I feel like she ain't singing to men anymore. She's just singing to her sisters. Maybe she is, and maybe I'm just a cat that can relate to some sisters. All I can say is I start relating to this album. I start to catch the groove. I got empathy. Just because I ain't a woman doesn't mean I can't relate to how a woman feels sometimes. So there you go. I'm proud to say it. I don't care. Rock and roll. Deal with it. I just have fucking feelings. Yeah, that's right. I said it. I got feelings. Nothing wrong with that. Men can have feelings too. So don't get too cool for school, Buster. I love Blue Bannisters, man. It gives me the feels big time. It's an emotional roller coaster. You feel like you've been in a relationship, Lana, by the time you're done with this album. It's like, now I know what it's like to live and love Lana Del Rey. Because she put me through the ringer with this album. It's an amazing album. Love it. And then we get to my second favorite Lana Del Rey album, which objectively, I think is her greatest album. Yes, objectively, I think this is her best album. And if I was recommending an album for you to listen to first, I'd probably say this one from 2019, Norman fucking Rockwell. Obviously, her greatest album title and greatest album cover. It's great. I love it. It's a piece of art in and of itself. This was, remember when I said that I felt back of Lust for Life, that with the follow-up, she really laid the gauntlet down and was like more Lana Del Rey than ever before? Well, this is the album I was talking about. She was like, fuck it, I'm not going pop. I'm going to go full on 100% Lana. I tried being a little poppier. I tried softening my edges. I tried bringing in The Weeknd, you know, to sing on a song. And you know what? Fuck it, I'm going to be me. I'm going to be me, but even more so. And she leaned into it. Everything from the album title to the album art to all the goddamn songs on the album, Lana leaned into being Lana and created a modern day masterpiece where she really, and not only did she lean into it, this wasn't a step backwards. It's like she reclaimed herself, but then took it to a whole other level. The craftsmanship, the songs, the mood, the pathos. She was obviously getting a little older and more sophisticated, and it all comes together in a beautiful way with this album. Track after track. This might be a concept album. I don't know. I mean, to a degree, every Lana Del Rey album is kind of a concept album. They all have a mood. They're kind of like those Frank Sinatra albums of the 60s and 70s, especially when he did like Only the Lonely and In the Small Wee Hours, where the albums had a vibe to them. And like he'd either have albums that were all swinging albums or albums that were all ballads. And so Frank Sinatra is really, he's the creator of the concept album. Not surprising, because Italian Americans create a lot of awesome shit. Just saying. But I suspect that Lana Del Rey albums are a little like concept albums too. They all have a very specific vibe and themes that run throughout the whole album. Norman fucking Rockwell, great song. Mariner's Apartment Complex, amazing song, very unique. Hear a little bit of that early 70s, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and Joni Mitchell kind of vibe going in and creeping in. That early 70s Southern California kind of folk rock. Venice Bitch, love Venice Bitch, great song. And even though it's soft and beautiful, as the title suggests, there's an edge to it. And I love that. Fuck It, I Love You. Great song, really catchy, romantic. beautiful romantic song, even though she drops an F-bomb, because that's what real love is. Real love is dropping the F-bomb. Doing Time, great cover of a Sublime song. And let me tell you something, I ain't a fan of Sublime, but when Lana sings Sublime, I like it. This is a really great song. Love song, Cinnamon Girl. Hey, Neil Young had a song called Cinnamon Girl, and this isn't even the same song. It's not a cover. It's some new Cinnamon Girl. Prince did the same thing. Prince did a song called Cinnamon Girl, and it was just a new Prince song. What's going on? What's going on with all these artists doing Cinnamon Girls, and they're not all the same goddamn song? That's weird. It's weird. That being said, it's a great song. I love it. There's enough room in this world for more than one great Cinnamon Girl. California. Beautiful song. Great song. Love the vibe, the mood. It little sounds like something that could have been on Honeymoon. Love it. The next best American record. That should have been a single and should have been a top 10 hit. God damn, that song's catchy. This song's so catchy. Starts off kind of folky, but then kicks into this cool kind of modern hip-hop R&B chorus. Really catchy. Totally 100% pure LDR. Recognize. Love it. The Greatest. Great song. I would hope a song called The Greatest is a great song. And sure enough, it is. This was a single. It's kind of a piano kind of singer-songwriter kind of sounding 70s song with a really cool guitar solo. She references Dennis Wilson in it, which I like. Big Dennis Wilson vibe running throughout this album. So I feel like she is probably listening to his album Pacific Ocean Blue, which is an amazing album. And I'll tell you what, during the summertime, I'm going to do a Dennis Wilson Pacific Ocean Blue Bamboo video because he's one of my favorite artists and he's great. And it sounds like Lana was listening to some Dennis Wilson when she did this shit. Bartender. It's my favorite song. Another song that sounds like a solo Dennis Wilson song. Piano ballad, but kind of a drunken kind of piano ballad. She's a drunk girl at a bar for good looking bartender. And oh, I love it. I love the vibe. I love how she sings during the chorus and plays around with the words. Amazing stuff. Amazing lyrics. Singing vibe. I love it. Great song to get drunk to. Hope is a dangerous thing for a woman like me to have, but I have it. What a great title. What a great lyric. Great song, very moving, and optimistic. One thing about Lana is even though she gets kind of mopey and sad at times, there's still an overriding optimism to her music, which I really respond to. Ultimately, she's embracing life, embracing the moment and the present, you know, while also recognizing the past. That's a hard thing to do. Recognizing the past and present at the same time. Every album feels like Lana is, as a person, growing and moving towards something. And that's what art used to be like. You know, that's the thing. People would listen to artists in the 60s and 70s, and every album was a representation of where they were as a person at that time and where they were going. And Lana's albums are like that. You know, you feel like I said, when you feel like Blue Bannisters, you feel like you've been in a relationship with her. You feel like while you're listening to her albums that you're growing with her, and we're all growing together, and we're all going through this shit. It's crazy world, and as things get crazier and crazier, it's more important to have real artists like Lana Del Rey, that are with us while we're growing through these crazy times. And that being said, let's get into what I think is my favorite, and it's not what I think, it's what I know, is my favorite Lana Del Rey album. And if you know your Lana Del Rey albums, you already figured out what this is. Like I said, objectively, I think like the four albums I put before this, I think are probably better. But subjectively, this is just my favorite, and I'll explain why. But 2014's Ultraviolence is my favorite Lana Del Rey album. I love this album. Ultraviolence. All right, so let's get into it. Now, this was her first proper release because Paradise was an EP. So this was her first full-length album since her big hit and big breakthrough album. There was a chance that Born to Die, as great as it was, could have been like, she could have been a one-hit wonder. It could have just been about that one album. Maybe she was just a novelty. Maybe this persona that she had cultivated was just an act. Maybe it would have all crumbled with the next album, but it didn't. And Ultraviolence is really the album where Lana showed that, yeah, she's going to be a real artist that's going to hang in there. And she's going to keep on making really good, solid albums. And this was when I went from being a guy to thinking, yeah, Born to Die is a cool album. I like it. And it's a nice album to listen to if you're a lady. But it was Ultraviolence was like, that's when I became a fan where with or without the lady, I was going to be listening to Lana Del Rey. It was with this album. And I guess it makes sense that I do like this album the best because it's the most rock of all her albums. This is the album that I think sounds kind of like indie rock. There's a lot of guitar on it. throughout. And the overall vibe is just a little more rock and roll. Sonically indie rock, but attitude-wise, hard rock. There is a hard rock swagger to this album, even though I wouldn't describe the music as hard rock. She still has some of the hip-hop vibe, too, from Born to Die as well. But it's mixed very organically into this perfect mix of rock, hip-hop, lounge, pop, and all seamless. Right from the first track, you hear it all of Cruel World. Love it. She's talking about drinking bourbon and, oh man, great lyrics. I just love the vibe. It has a great, boozy, let's love each other because the world's burning kind of vibe. I love Cruel World. Ultraviolence, amazing song. Shades of Cool, really great. Probably one of the greatest hipster pop songs ever written. Brooklyn Baby, same thing I just said about the last song. Apply it to this song. West Coast, one of her greatest songs. Love West Coast. I guess it's a hip-hop pop song. Really cool, sneaky guitar line mixed in with the beat. Oh, man. And she just sounds badass. It's got a swagger to it. It's got this badass white girl cruising down the Malibu kind of vibe. I love it. Sad Girl, like it. Great song. Pretty When You Cry, great. Money, Power, Glory. This is where we get into the Money Trilogy, the Power Trilogy, all right? Money, Power, and Glory. Powerful song. Powerful song. This is some white girl gangster shit. Love Money, Power, Glory. But my favorite song on the album is the next song, Fucked My Way Up to the Top. God damn, is this a great song. And it's not just because she says fuck my way up to the top, although that does not hurt. It's a cool title for a song. And some woman had to have a song called that at some point. And Lana was the one ballsy enough to say, fuck it, I'll be the one to have this song. And man, it's just so catchy. And when it just hits that chorus, you just want to get into that shit, man. This is just victory scotch, dark heart of LA and success and To me, this song captures the vibe of everything that's great and horrible simultaneously about Los Angeles and the entertainment business. I love this song. It's the dark, black, beautiful heart of Hollywood. Fucked My Way Up to the Top. Amazing song. Old Money. There you go, which ends this, the Money Suite, the Money and Power Suite. Great song. And The Other Woman, which is a very kind of more traditional, old-school sounding song where she's expressing pathos towards the other woman. Great way to end the album. Amazing album. My personal favorite. Like I said, objectively, I'd say Norman fucking Rockwell and Blue Bannisters and Honeymoon and Chemtrails are probably all a little bit better in this album. But man, this album just does it for me. It's the most rock and roll. I love it. And I think it'll always be my favorite. It's also the one, from what I've heard, sounds the best on vinyl, too. So there you go. Ultraviolence, my favorite Lana Del Rey album. They're all great. Lust for Life in her debut. They're just good. But all the others are great albums, and you should definitely listen to them. Trust me, these albums will creep in there. They will creep under your skin and penetrate your soul, man. And that's what music's supposed to do, man. Let's not fuck around here. Let's get into it. Let's have our souls be penetrated. God damn it. In fact, I'm going to pour myself just a little bit more Nectar of the Gods so we can wrap up, because I want to wrap up with a little more scotch. Something about Lana Del Rey makes me want to drink scotch. There we go. Don't judge. Don't judge. So that's it. That's my Lana Del Rey ranking. And I hope you enjoyed it. It was a boozy good time. I hope it was, anyway. And that's that. O-U-T spells out. Later.